Hello and welcome to Policy Watch, your packed snapshot of the week's biggest business developments, their context, their relevance and policy impact. I'm Govind Raj Ethiraj. Retail inflation has eased sharply by 100 basis points to 5.05% in August after having hit a near two-year high of 6.07% in July. But there is not some good news too. India's Index of Industrial Production, or IIP, reported a negative growth of minus 2.4% in July after growing 1.95% the month before. The fall in retail inflation was driven by lower food prices, while lower IIP numbers were driven by slower production of capital goods and consumer non-durables. A lower inflation rate has brought back quite quickly receding expectations of a rate cut. So, how do we interpret these slowing IIP numbers, and will a policy remedy address both issues? To discuss this, I'm joined by DK Joshi, Chief Economist of CRISIL, and Brinda Chagidar, Economist. Thank you both for joining me. DK, let me begin with you. So, we're looking at two different sets of data here. We're looking at falling inflation, which is good news, but we're also looking at falling index of industrial production numbers, which is not so good news. How are you interpreting it?
Well, I think inflation slide was expected. I think if you look at the analyst predictions, I think everyone was expecting it to go down, and it's going to go down further also, as I think one is the base effect and the second is because of normal monsoons. I think some of the food items which were putting pressure earlier are going to get subdued, like pulses, etc. So there is an expectation that inflation will remain benign. I think as far as IIP is concerned, I think my major concern is on the index itself. I mean, it's a pretty dated index and on 2004-05 base, and many of the things it includes don't have much relevance now. So the first is that the base needs to be changed, and in the current form it displays a lot of volatility, which at times is not in tune with reality. So I think so one needs to interpret the IIP numbers with caution. It is not reflective of what's going on in the economy.
A concern that has been voiced, including by your firm, is that 75% of its manufacturing weightage, and that in turn has slowed down. So how do we take that figure?
Well, manufacturing is not roaring. I mean, but it's not. I mean, I won't expect manufacturing to slow down to these to this extent. I mean, so what I'm saying is many of the items that are captured, like for instance, the capital goods decline was essentially due to a fall in one category called cables, I mean, which fell very sharply. So I think it has, IIP has many idiosyncratic elements. As far as manufacturing is concerned, I think it's, the growth is weak. I think the investment scenario also is weak there. But I think I just want to highlight the fact that IIP is kind of emphasizing the weakness in the industrial sector.
Okay. I'll come back to inflation in a moment. Brinda, what's your sense? Are you in consonance with DK's view on IIP numbers?
I would completely agree that where IIP is concerned, we certainly need a lot more granularity in the data. Mm-hmm. Like, for example, the electricity has done well, mining has done well, but not, I won't say well, but at least they are positive. Mm. But it's only manufacturing which has completely dragged down. And even within manufacturing, it is just one commodity, which has one item,
right,
which has pulled down the whole index. Mm. So this is giving a picture as if the situation is very bleak, but whereas the reality is that is not so. And also, if you look within the segments, basic goods and intermediate goods, those are increasing. Consumer non-durables, as you rightly said, that has also increased. So there are pockets of strong growth within the IIP. We need to capture that rather than let one or two commodities distort.
Okay, DK, assuming, let's say, we don't give too much importance to this index or this number, what is there some other figure or other index that we can correlate with, which say is showing a stronger performance or something that we can more believe perhaps with greater confidence?
Well, I think the PMI, for instance, is showing improvement, and I think so that's a forward-looking indicator. And the IIP has been in complete contrast with that. Both of them are not always synced, but I think this contrast is rather too sharp. And then second is, I think the durables part, I think that is still strong. I mean, as Brinda was also pointing out. So I think some of the indicators at the ground level don't show that much weakness as the manufacturing data from IIP is showing.
Brinda, what do we then take these figures as? So suppose we were to look at it over a three-month period, we saw it strong in July, weak in August. So does this mean that we ignore this as a blip and then focus maybe forward?
No, I think we can't ignore this as a blip because certainly manufacturing is weak. Now, for example, if you take the RBI data which has been put out last year, the private sector, private credit which went out, 50% was on account of power. Of the remaining, the bulk went to rail, ports, airports, and it is only a very small percentage which went. So manufacturing from did not really do well. There was no capex, and there was no growth in investment in the manufacturing, private manufacturing. So that weakness needs certainly to be addressed. That is what the data.
So
is
to that extent,
you.
The IIP numbers have some message to give us.
Yes. Okay. But at the same time, it distorts the picture. So we need to look at it along with the other leading indicators that DK just mentioned. So PMI is a very important indicator. Bank credit is another important indicator. The diesel offtake, cement offtake. Right. Let us look at a combination.
Right. So if you were to take this combination, as Brinda says, DK, what is it adding up to? I mean, how optimistic does the situation really look then?
Well, let me add one more proxy, which is the excise collections. I mean, if the industrial sector is so weak, how come excise collections are so strong? So there are some disconnects. So I mean, what I would say is that industry or manufacturing is weak. There's no doubt about it. But it's not as weak as this month's data is showing. Maybe in next month you'll see it move again into the positive territory. So I think the problem is that you cannot use 1 month data to infer about what's going to happen over the next 2-3 months. So I would keep looking at a broad-based set of indicators to infer about industry, then just focus on IIP.
DK, let's return to inflation then. So if you were to look at the inflation numbers, and considering that even if you don't put too much credence on the IIP numbers, we can go with the assumption that the economy needs some kind of kick. Would the low inflation numbers add or provide that incentive?
Well, I think they increase the possibility of a rate cut. And I think rate cut is not the solution for everything that's happening in the economy. But anyway, it will provide mild support apart from improving the sentiment. And that rate cut, we don't think will happen in October itself, but maybe towards the end of the year. So that is one way in which lower inflation can support the economy via lower interest rates.
So Brinda, you know, just a month and a half ago, we had completely ruled out a rate cut, right? So now, because we've seen a near 100 basis points reduction in inflation, we're immediately asking for one. So is there something that, are these too wild, these swings, and therefore can we be arriving at decisions so fast?
These swings are really wild, and I think we needn't jump so fast. Now, for example, if you look at even the data, good monsoons have helped to bring down food prices. Not only the monsoons, even government steps to make sure that the distribution, procurement, etc. is good, and it has a positive impact on supplies. But at the same time, core inflation still remains sticky, and the other component of inflation, that is the services, that is going up, healthcare, education. So that is pushing up inflation. So it's not as if inflation is completely under control and everything is hunky-dory. And also, there are a lot of external factors which we need to take into account. A lot of external uncertainties, global situation, how that is going to impact.
So when you say uncertainty, you mean on the
US elections,
liquidity,
the Fed rate, you know, so those kind of which is outside our control, but which will impact the economy. So we need to be watchful. And of course, the huge outflow on account of the FCNR deposits,
right,
which is starting from September.
Okay.
So we need to see
The RBI is confident that this can go through quite smoothly.
True, but then it's not a given.
Yeah.
So certainly RBI has taken the right steps, and it has infused that kind of confidence in the markets. But these uncertainties are there. So we need to, I would agree that the space for a rate cut has certainly emerged now with inflation under control. And going forward, we will see inflation falling. But we need to look through the base effects, and we need to see how sustained this inflation, this coming down of inflation is. So I think there's still a little bit of time to wait. Maybe by December, we can expect a rate cut.
So DK, if you were to look at a sort of composite outlook outline a composite outlook with all of these, what would it be for the next quarter or so?
Well, I think as far as the economy is concerned, I would see the consumption sector pick up even more because the good monsoons will start bearing fruits in terms of increase in income for farmers. And the consumption in India will become more balanced. It was flying on urban consumption as of now. So rural will add to that. But I think despite consumption picking up, there's still excess capacity in the economy, and industry will have to grow much faster to get rid of that excess capacity. And unless that happens, we should not expect the private investment scenario to look good. And we expect private and corporate investments to pick up at least after a year. I mean, so for a year, I think people will be, or the industry will be on the wait and watch mode. And by the way, the manufacturing sector, which we were talking about, I think it's entirely a private sector enterprise. I think almost more than 90% of output, more than 90% of investments are done by the private sector. So unless the capacity utilization scenario improves, we don't see investments happening. So I think the moral is, or story is, that the consumption oriented sectors will continue to do well, whether it is industry. The investment linked activities will remain subdued.
Just one quick question there, DK. So, but we continue to see consistent public spending or rise in public spending. You don't feel that's offsetting anything?
No, it does. I mean, it prevents the further slide. I mean, it prevents the slide in overall investments. I think if government had not stepped in, investments would have fallen even more. So right now the story is that wherever government is intervening or is investing, like roads, etc., things are looking good. But there are other areas where I think the animal spirits will decide whether the investment takes place or not. I think that part is weak. So government support is critical. It will crowd in or help draw in private investments over time. But as of now, I think we have to live in a subdued investment environment for this fiscal at least.
Okay, so outlook for the next quarter or so?
On the consumption side, I think the picture is pretty good. Mm. But I would worry on the investment side, because investment has not picked up at all. I would also worry on the side of the banks, because even if RBI does cut the rates, are banks in a position to pass on the rate cut? So is transmission, that pipeline, has that been cleaned up? And are banks in a position to support growth?
Right, we've run out of time. Thank you, Brinda. Thank you, DK. We need to go in for a break. Coming up on the other side, the markets have been losing some sleep and some steam off late. Let's find out why. Stay with us. Welcome back to Policy Watch. After a major liquidity-driven surge, global and Indian markets have taken a breather. After hitting a high of 29,045 last week, the BSE Sensex is now around 28,726. Now, the decline in itself is not much, given the markets have been steadily rising after having touched around 23,000 in late February this year. The Sensex fell 500 points last week on the heels of big sell-offs in Asia and American markets, but also recovered somewhat on Friday. Now, the big global concerns were rising bond yields and worries that the Federal Reserve may have raised rates. Now, strong markets have also seen many companies pushing through with their initial public offers, and state-owned enterprises are waiting in the wings. The larger question is, how strong is the base in Indian markets? Why is India being impacted in this way, and what way could it go? And how do we interpret this current volatility, and till when could it last? To discuss this, I'm joined by Dipen Mehta, member of Bombay Stock Exchange, Devendra Nevgi, CEO of Xyphin Advisors, and Ashish Kayal, founder of Wave Strategy Advisors. Thank you all for joining me. Dipen, let me begin with you. I know the markets have been going up and down, but also were surprised to some extent by what we saw were concerns in the US on a Federal Reserve rate hike. So to what extent should we be worried about these inputs or these events in future?
See, I think Indian markets are heavily dependent on FII flows. And whenever there's a risk off trade because of some global event like Fed increasing its interest rates or curtailment of the quantitative easing by any of the global banks. So if there's a risk of trade, then you know we see FII flows exiting in droves from our country, and that does impact the markets over here. But these are basically temporary phenomena, and as soon as this particular issue gets resolved globally and there is a semblance of stability in the global equity markets, then we see resumption of FII buying. And then the markets start to resume on the bull market trail. So there is something in the short term that we should be worried about, that being US increasing its interest rates, as well as some of the other central bankers now looking at least curtailing or keeping their quantitative easing in check. And that certainly could have an impact on Indian equity markets over here. But I think that over the next 2-3 years, I think over the longer term, I think prospects remain pretty decent for our equities over here. But short term, one should be expected for some sort of a turmoil if there's a global sell-off in equities.
So how strong is, let me ask this one to you, Ashish, first, how strong is our base? I mean, where do things stop, or where do things sort of slow down? So last time, Govind, we discussed that the entire rally is probably liquidity driven, mm-hmm. and that is what has led markets on the higher prices rather than any strong fundamental reason. Mm-hmm. So I still live by that, and I think the sell-off which we saw just last Monday was a significant example of how risky we have become. And it's not just India that has sold off. Mm. If you check on Monday's chart, it was Asian market, it was Dow Jones, UK markets, it was Brazil, Hong Kong. So it was a broad-based sell-off which we saw in a single day. Mm. And it has been almost 4 days, still we have not able to fill up that gap. So it just shows how sensitive we are right now. And the valuations, if you check, is definitely expensive. Mm. There will be a lot of reasoning which will come in and say that these valuations are justified. Mm. And every time we the PE ratio, trailing PE ratio reaches around 24, 25 levels, there are some justifications that comes in. Mm. But definitely, I doubt that that is sustainable at current levels. Mm. Either the earnings have to catch up with the valuations, or market should consolidate and correct in order to justify the high valuations that we are claiming right now.
Right. And therefore, maybe let me ask a twin question then. Dipen, what's the bottom then and what's the ceiling?
No, I don't want to call for a bottom or, you know, give specific targets for the Sensex or the Nifty. All that we can say is that this is a multi-year long-term bull market and it will go many levels higher, but that investors should be prepared for a 5 to 15% correction at any point of time because of global events or could be even local events. But the underlying fundamentals of the Indian economy are stable and gradually improving as well. So that's just what one needs to keep in mind, and we have got many positives to look forward to. There is GST, of course, for one, and this time the festive season also may be excellent for a lot of companies because the monsoons have been good. And then we have the budget coming up in Jan or Feb, whenever that takes place. So we have many positive events to look forward to. But as I said, I think, you know, if there's a global, sort of a meltdown or a global sell-off because of bond market challenges over there, then we won't escape that sell-off and we will see temporary prices being depressed over here. But those, I think, would be opportunities to increase exposure to equity.
So, Ashley, let me put the question differently. So, we've seen strong domestic flows, right? While we're also seeing very strong international or foreign portfolio flows. To what extent can the domestic flows hold our bottom, even if you don't put a number to it?
Okay, so for example, there has been a lot of foreign inflows that has been coming in, and also DIIs, if you check over past few weeks, have been a major sellers. Mm. So what will happen in case there is some amount which is then pulled out of the economy or pulled out of the market, then we can find we can be very, very cautious at that stage. At the same time, one very important aspect that one should look at is the advance decline ratio that measures what is the overall breadth of the market. Mm. Now, in this entire rally which started on Nifty at 6825 in February 2016 from the budget day, the entire rise has happened on a lesser number of stocks participating.
Okay.
So the advance decline ratio has been constantly deteriorating, which shows that there has been lesser and lesser number of stocks that are participating in the rally. And a true bull market, we need to see participation from majority of the stocks, because if the economy is truly going to do good, then it's the smaller and mid-cap companies that should outperform. So even when the mid-cap and small-cap indices are at new highs, the number of stocks that participated in the rally has been very less.
Right. So Dipen, you pointed out some of the macroeconomic factors which will sort of hold the bottom, so to speak. Are there similar liquidity reasons which could be, I mean, I'm talking about domestic as opposed to international?
See, Govind, I think one of the most amazing aspects of this bull market as compared to the three or four that we have seen earlier is that retail investor is coming to the mutual fund route, and a lot of them are coming through the SIP means as well. And that really is the most interesting aspect of this bull market, and that gives confidence that this bull market will sustain for many years, because truly we are seeing more and more household savings getting deployed to equities. Mutual funds per se have done a great job in terms of delivering returns to investors, and now I think the common man on the street also has understood the advantages of going through a mutual fund or a portfolio manager or at least some advisor and not going through the equity markets by themselves. At the same time, I think leverage positions are absolutely on the lower side, and I think that liquidity wise, the liquidity supply from the domestic investors will certainly keep on rising. But coming to the point that why FII flows are important is because of the momentum with which the FIIs buy and sell. That cannot be matched by the domestic investors, institutional or otherwise. And all over all these last 15-20 years, what we have seen is that the FIIs are the price makers and the domestic institutional investors are the price takers. So although we are seeing more and more investments coming through the domestic institutional investors, but end of the day, the shots will continue to be called by the FIIs just because of the momentum that they create when they enter or exit Indian markets.
Devinder, you know, we were seeing a pretty strong trend until last week. The markets were looking strong, liquidities were moving very steadily and strongly, but somehow suddenly things seem to have reversed, obviously with a liquidity turn. So what's really driving this?
So, you know, Govind, my personal feeling is that what exactly has happened, if you look at the way market has moved since Brexit, you know, it's almost up by 30% returns on the top line, whereas some of the mid caps have been flying. So what happens is that the liquidity, when it comes in, it doesn't recognize the good and bad. It hits the stocks across the board. And that is the reason, if you see, the correlation between the movements of stocks was very high. So the rising tide of liquidity was taking up all the stocks. But at some point of time, the market then becomes more fairly valued. And then the large caps stopped going up. So the money moves from large cap because they are not going up to mid caps. Then the mid caps start moving. So these are the typical liquidity cycle what happens. So this is exactly being happening, that the mid caps are now rising. There will be flavors and colors. So you had earlier banks going up, NBFCs going up, metals going up, and the flavor of the day was yesterday you had the cable TV stocks going up. So this is a typical example of a liquidity driven rally, which is not exactly backed by a macro changes in the macro.
So the question is that, you know, so what is the base in India, right? So we've seen the market go up since March, 23,000 to now 28,000 plus, touching 29,000. Yeah. So where is our base, number one? Number two, how strong is it?
So it is difficult to take a base as a benchmark, but it is not that Indian markets only have gone up. If you see, the emerging market as an asset class is attracting money. The money that is attracted by emerging asset classes close to around 10 odd billion. And the Indian markets from Jan equity have attracted around net flows of 6.4 billion. So India is not different from all the emerging asset classes. So I think from a valuations perspective, we are at on a trailing PE, Nifty is at 24. And if you go historically, whenever the trailing PE ratio is 24, and the frequency is lower, nevertheless the returns has been negative. They have been really negative in double digits. And if you go a little ahead in the PE ratio of 27 and 28, where we might reach, the returns have been as average returns in the next 1 year has been as low as -38%.
Yeah. So what it means is that if you invest 100 rupees today versus, let's say, 100 rupees invested a year ago, you will be not making money.
So, you know, we have to understand that we have to temper the expectations of the investors at this point of time. The big rally is not expected to be happening because of the valuation. Now, if the corrections happen, there is a good chance for the market to again go back, and it has to be supported by earnings growth, which is a mixed bag now. So earning growth and the economic data being positive is very important. Liquidity can sustain it for 6 months, but beyond that, earnings.
So let me flip the question that I asked you about a base. So what's then the top, if there is one, and what's the sort of outlook that goes with it?
See, as I said, Govind, number is really difficult to put a number on that. I did rather believe in the valuations rather than that number. So I think
so that's also a top in some ways, isn't it?
Yeah, this might be a top. So for me, you know, as I said, the P ratio was 24 is something which is a fair valuation, which is now. And as I said, going ahead, the market will probably get some momentum from the flows. But the flows could be incrementally lower as the valuations get on.
Right, and this is global as well as domestic.
Yeah, it is. In fact, if you see globally also, the flows are as strong as India. Mm. In fact, more than India. Mm. And some of the markets like Brazil have done much better than India as far as the dollar and vis-a-vis the dollar, the local currency as well as in the dollar.
Right. So, what's your outlook if you were to look ahead for the next 3 months? So, because, you know, a lot of companies, even maybe state-owned enterprises, were getting ready for public offers, will go ahead with public offers. Is this a good market overall?
Yeah, I think from a money raising perspective, it's a good market because the cost of equity is lower, and that's the reason you are seeing a slew of initial public offering. I mean, I'm seeing at least twice, two or three a week, which are of reasonable size. Mm. So
quality as well or size?
Yeah, quality and size, okay. Both. There are some good, some bad. Mm. But the point is that those bad are hitting the market. Mm. That is one thing which we all have to look at. So you have to segregate the men and the boys amongst them, because all this comes at the peak of the market. If you see the huge supply, whether from the government or from the promoters, it comes at the peak of the market. Right. So that is the key thing which we'll have to watch. I think from a 3 months perspective, market will not rally rapidly. Mm. There are risks which includes the Fed,
right,
the FCNRB, the elections also. We have to be mindful of these risk creating volatility.
Last question, Ashish, and a quick one. What's your outlook?
See, over short to medium term, I think the rally is overstretched. Mm. We should see some kind of a correction. And right now, retail participants should use a very strict stop loss or risk they need to manage very well, because there can be sudden reversals which might happen.
Okay.
Over the long term horizon, from 5 years perspective, I'm extremely bullish on Indian markets. We should definitely do much better from here on. But short term, definitely it's time for us to be cautious.
Ashish, thank you. We've run out of time. Thank you, Dipen and Devendra. That's all we have time for in this edition of Policy Watch. We'll be back next week, same time. Thanks for watching.